you to open your hymnals and sing all the verses of Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee, number 89.
Church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. Good morning, church. Hope you're all having a great week so far, and thank you for choosing our church to come and worship. Nathan normally comes here, but he said, hey, best man on the job, I need you to do announcements again. So here I am. I just wanted, if you haven't taken the moment yet, just grab the sign-in pads at the end of your rows and sign in. We want to know who all came this morning, and also sign in for Wednesday Night Live if you'll be there this Wednesday. And if you're visiting us for the first time, thank you for choosing our church to come and worship. We're glad to see you, and hopefully you enjoy this worship service. Just a few announcements this morning. There will be youth tonight at 5. We kicked it off last week with 80s night. I think it went pretty well. And then we're going to start our regular programming tonight. We're going to finish a sermon series called Unlikely Heroes. So, youth, if you're out there, we're meeting tonight at 5. And then also, Nathan is starting his Creed series tonight at 5 in the Upper Room Sunday School class. It is in this building. If you go up the stairs, it's the big building, big room with all the tables and stuff. It's the longest room up there. So tonight at 5, anyone is welcome. And if you want a book, I know he said he's kind of not going to go according to the book, but it's still a good resource to read. If you want that, speak to Nathan. after service, and he will hook you up with that. And that is all the announcements today, so I want to invite Emily up for the prayer.
As we prepare to go to the Lord in prayer, let us remember these.
Bobby Hughes, Harriet Kundi, Walter Allman, Don Tatum, Bob Calvert, Linda Burmese, and Nell Thomas. Let us pray. Lord God, whose power and mercy has extended to all of creation, pour your love on us this day, that we might be healed and be made ready to serve you by serving others in this world that you have created. Lord God, forgive us again, as you so often have before, when we have failed to be your witness and your workers. Help us become involved in ministries of peace and justice, right where we are. For there is nowhere in creation where your love is not needed. Let us bring messages of love and hope to all people. Bring us to an understanding of the partnership of healing and hope that abides in your service. We ask these things in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now we invite our children to come up and sing.
Loud enough just yet. I have a wonderful group of boys and girls who come on Wednesdays, and I have about this many more that come that go to other churches. But we're going to share our first song today. It's going to be a song called Who Did? And we were talking about faith this week. And in this song, Jonah was swallowed by a whale, and God saved him. And Gabriel blew his trumpet, and of course Daniel showed real faith because he went into a lion's den. Did he come out alive? Yes, he did. He had faith in God. So we're going to sing a little song called Who Did? And they're going to sing some of the words, and I may come in every now and then, okay? Well, first of all, my boys and girls, I'm so happy to have y'all here, so please let's show them your best smile. You sing much better with a smile. All righty. Here we go.
Who did swallow Jonah?
Well, they did such a good job that we're going to do the next song, and they want you to sing with us. They said, let's let everybody in the congregation sing with us. It's a little thing called Do Lord. I believe you know that. So, and I'm hoping some of these, I actually have some people in the choir today that's never been to choir, but they're doing a great job. All righty.
For the Lord, and I thank Miss Donna for taking the time to work with the children.
May I speak in front
of you? Yes, you may. She did a wonderful job, and I'm so proud of you. I want to tell you what happened to me yesterday. Yeah. Yesterday, I love ice cream. You like ice cream? I do too. My favorite kind is homemade peach ice cream. But when I can't have homemade ice cream, I like Bluebell milk chocolate. Yummy. Well, there was this movie on TV that I wanted to watch yesterday afternoon. I've seen it 900 times, but I love it. It's called The Goonies. Have you ever watched it? I know it. I love that movie. I do. And so I was going to fix me a ice cream cone. So I went to the freezer, and I got out the ice cream and got me a spoon out. And I dug at my ice cream. Look what happened to my spoon. Look what happened to my spoon. It got all bent out of shape. Now, I can't, well, sort of, I can still use it. It was kind of hard to get it out of. Hey, I may do. If I had to, I'd just eat it out of the carton. But this spoon is not much good to me, and if I were trying to eat soup out of it, it would just run all down my shirt. That would be. This spoon was not important to me anymore. It wasn't very good. Now, I've got a story to tell you from the Bible about some people who were bent out of shape. There were two people. The first person I want to tell you about that was bent out of shape was this lady. Jesus was in the church teaching, and while he was teaching, he saw a lady that was crippled. She had been crippled for 18 years, and when he saw this lady, guess what he did? What do you think Jesus did? He healed her, that's right. He healed her. He said, woman, you're healed from your sickness. And he touched her, and all of a sudden that woman stood up straight and she was not bent over anymore. Huh? He left it rain. Yes, he does make it rain. I wish he'd let it rain some at my house. But she stood up straight. She had been bent over all her life. And when he healed her, she was straight. Well, the second person in my story got bent out of shape then. It was the leader of the church, and he was angry. He was angry because Jesus had healed somebody on Sunday, and that was against the law, he said. Well, when Jesus found out about that, he said, you phony, don't you hook up your donkey and lead him to drink water on Sunday? Well, I think that people are more important to take care of on Sunday. Now, Jesus thought that taking care of this person was important, but he also broke the rules. Now, rules are important, don't get me wrong, but taking care of people are important too. So the next time you get bent out of shape, you think about what Jesus did. He loved these people. And he took care of their needs, and that's what you should do also. Let's bow our heads for a moment of prayer. Dear God, we just thank you for Jesus that shows us love and shows us the importance of loving people. Help us that when we get bent out of shape, that we will always remember that we should love people and take care of their needs. And all God's children said, amen. And you may go to Children's Church.
Let us pray. God of all, we are so thankful for this opportunity to give to you today. Multiply these gifts so that your world may experience your care. Awaken us so that our need to act faithfully is reflected in how we speak and how we serve. In your holy name, amen.
And peace from my sin I sought release. Then my Savior came and I was saved by grace. I've been saved by grace. I've been born from above. I've been washed in the blood of the Lamb. Now I'm living in God's power every day and every hour. I've been saved and sanctified. Savior's face. No one else would ever do what he did for me and you. All who trust in him can surely save by grace. Saved by grace, I've been born from above. Washed in the blood of the Lamb. Now I'm living in God's power every day. I've been saved and sanctified.
hymnal to number 121. Our hymn of preparation is number 121. There's a wideness in God's mercy. We'll sing all the verses. Please remain standing for the reading of the gospel. Our gospel reading today comes from the gospel according to Luke. And we are in Luke's gospel chapter 13. So I invite you to turn in your Bible to Luke chapter 13. If you have not brought your Bible with you today, I invite you to use the pew Bible. There is a pew Bible available in the pew rack in front of you. Our reading begins in the 10th verse and it continues through to the 17th verse. Let's listen for God's word. Now he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and just then there appeared a woman with a spirit that had crippled her for 18 years. She was bent over and was quite unable to stand up straight. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and said, "Woman, you are set free from your ailment." And when he laid his hands on her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. But the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, kept saying to the crowd, "There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days to be cured, and not on the Sabbath day." But the Lord answered him and said, "You hypocrites! Does not each one of you on the Sabbath untie his ox and his donkey from the manger and lead it away to give it water? And ought not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan bound for 18 long years, be set free from this bondage on the Sabbath day?" When he said this, his opponents were put to shame. The entire crowd was rejoicing at all the wonderful things that he was doing. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated, please. Today's story is a window into the heart of God. When we want to know what God looks like, what God acts like, what is important to God, what God's heart is like, we have been given the great gift of the words and actions of Jesus Christ. He is the Word of God. He is what God has to say about himself. When we see what Jesus does, it causes us to reprioritize. It causes us to find out how God's value system is different than our own. And so today, we find a story that's set in a situation very much like what we find ourselves in today. We've all gathered for church, and we all dressed up nice and brushed our teeth today, you know, made ourselves smell a little bit better than usual, and we all look like good, respectable church people today, right? And this whole scene of people being good religious people is interrupted when a woman whose body has been broken, a woman who is stooped over and completely unable to stand up straight, comes in on the Sabbath day, and Jesus stops everything. He says, "We're putting the bulletin aside and taking care of God's work." And he calls her over, interrupts everything, the songs, the prayers, everything. Stop, stop. No children's minute. Stop everything. Because God cares for this child, this daughter of his own. And he reaches out to her and sets her free. She stands up straight for the first time in 18 years. Jesus is the guest preacher that day. And there is a synagogue leader. The preacher gets up and says, wait. Hold on. If healing is work, and Sabbath is a day of no work, and so if you want to get healed, God can heal you on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Sunday, Sabbath is Saturday. He says, there's 6 days. He gets all twisted up, bent out of shape. It gets on his nerves that Jesus would set aside what they're supposed to be doing in church to do something they're not supposed to be doing. Miss Janey said that there were two people bent out of shape in this story. The reality is there was three. Because there was the woman who was bent out of shape physically. There was the synagogue leader who was bent out of shape that his worship service got interrupted and his rules got messed up. But when that man was unable to rejoice in the miracle God had done for that woman, Jesus got bent out of shape. That got on Jesus' nerves. Because he had the heart of God to see a person who's hurting and to notice them. To notice this woman who was so easy to dismiss, to ignore. Part of my sermon preparation is listening to a podcast. I listen to a podcast called Sermon Brainwave, and it's based on the lectionary texts. And so every week I listen to these three Bible professors who live up north someplace, and they talk about the text every week. And I've been listening to this podcast for a long, long time. One of the presenters on Sermon Brainwave is a man named Rolf Jacobson. And until this week, what I didn't realize is that Rolf Jacobson, this Bible teacher, he has no legs. His legs have been amputated. And so I've listened to him. He's a great Bible teacher. He's the best of the three, by far. And when he was talking about the story of this woman who is dismissed, who's overlooked, who's ignored, he said, I know something about this because I've been in a wheelchair for a long time. He says, when I go out in public, there are two reactions. He says, children stare at me. And he said, adults do their very best to look away, to not look at me. How many kinds of people in our lives are we tempted to ignore, to overlook, to avoid? Sometimes it's people with disabilities. Sometimes it's people we just don't have time for because we're way too busy. Sometimes they're people that we think are different than ourselves. Sometimes they're people who make us nervous. Sometimes we overlook people because we see them for their function instead of who they are as human beings. A great writer named G.K. Chesterton used to write mystery stories. They were called the Father Brown stories. Anybody ever read a G.K. Chesterton story? I love G.K. Chesterton. In one of his stories, there's a murderer who nearly gets away with murder because nobody ever sees the murderer when he goes in to murder somebody because he's the postman. He's the postman. So all they see is the postman. They don't notice a person. It's easy to overlook each other, but Jesus sees. He sees God's child. He looks into her eyes. He addresses her by name. He sees not a crippled person. He sees not a distraction from the work of the church that day. He sees a daughter of Abraham. And as much as we work real hard to come into church looking like good church people, every single one of us, because we're human beings, comes in some way with our hearts and our lives broken. There's something in us that is bent over and stooped up, and we have tried to fix it, but in no way can we fix ourselves. And we're trying so hard to cover it up, to look right. And it's important for us to recognize the heart of a God who sees us for who we are and looks at us not in judgment and condemnation. He looks at us with compassion and a desire to heal us and to give us nothing but grace and make us whole. What is it about yourself that causes you to feel invisible or to want to be invisible? Some people feel invisible and not seen for themselves because of their poverty. Some people feel like they can't be seen for who they are because of their wealth. Some people are overlooked because of their race or their physical challenge or some quirk of their personality. Some people are overlooked and we don't see them as people because of their past. All we can see is what happened a long time ago. Sometimes we look at ourselves and all we see is who we were before. Sometimes we overlook our humanity or the humanity of others because of our present. We define ourselves by what's broken in our lives at this point. God sees past what's on the outside. God sees the heart. The Bible says human beings, they look on the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. He looks at his children in the eyes and he sees the broken place in each of us. He's not afraid. He's not ashamed. He doesn't look away. He doesn't condemn. He doesn't blame. God is moved with compassion for the broken places in his children. He is moved with compassion. Is not surprised by our weakness. This woman is stooped over and totally unable to stand up. There's a popular phrase. Some people think it's in the Bible. It is not in the Bible. There's a phrase that says, God helps those who help themselves. How many of you have ever heard, God helps those who help themselves? I am so grateful that God helps those who can't help themselves. Because that means that God can help a person like me. How many of you ever heard, pick yourselves up by your own bootstraps? You ever heard that? Have you ever tried to pick yourselves up by your own bootstrap and you realize, I don't have any boots? Right? God does great with people who've lost their boots, who can't help themselves. That's what grace means. So here we are in our Father's house, and we can luxuriate in God's grace. We can present unashamed our powerlessness before the power of God and find healing from a God who doesn't look away from us. Have you ever tried to straighten up? Yeah. I try to straighten up every New Year's. I make a list of my resolutions. Sometimes I make it to like January 4th, 5th. Every Lent, I'm going to give this up. Do you want a cookie? Yes. Right? Have you ever tried to straighten up? And you can't do it. Sometimes it's not until you try to straighten up that you realize, I can't do this on my own. She could in no wise straighten herself out. and neither can you. Whether it be that place of unforgiveness and you say, I need to forgive, but then something happens and you realize, I haven't forgiven. Whether it's your anxiety, be anxious for nothing, I'm trying. Right? Your compulsion and your habit, I need to not do that anymore. And you can't let it go. And you think that God condemns you because your efforts aren't good enough. I'm here to tell you that God doesn't condemn you. God loves you. And God wants you to be free. And if you will be honest with Him about the truth of your condition, and you will avail yourself of all the healing that He has to offer, there is power to be made whole. It doesn't come easy. It usually doesn't come in a minute. Sometimes we need each other's help. But there's power to be made whole, and there's a God who is unashamed with our weakness. So this synagogue leader says, go get healed another day. He's indignant. I hate to say it, but there is something in religious people that gets indignant about God putting people ahead of our traditions and our ways. Have you ever been around indignant religious people? Am I the only one who's been around an indignant religious person or two? I've been around a few. I'll tell some stories if you like. None of them came from this church. All right, here we go. One time, there was this kid who invited his friend to church, and the kid didn't come. And so he started to pray for this kid. His friend had never been to a church in his whole life. Never, ever been to a church. Ever, any church. No church. Can you imagine? He prayed for this kid and invited him month after month after month, and one day, the kid said, yeah, I'll go to church with you. And he showed up to church, and he was wearing a hat. And somebody who didn't know this kid said, son, you need to take off that hat in the church. And that kid had no idea he wasn't supposed to wear a hat in church, because he'd never been to church before. But that religious person was indignant that this kid was breaking a rule that he didn't even know about. And guess what happened? That kid never came back to the church. But if that person who had no idea what he was doing, he had no idea what he was doing, right? But if he'd taken a minute to find out, maybe instead of being indignant, he could have rejoiced. Here's a kid who's never heard the gospel, never been to a church, and now he's come to our church and he's finding out that Jesus loves him. Eventually, he's going to figure out not to wear a hat. In the meantime, can we rejoice instead of being indignant? Oof. I reacted that day like Jesus. I got so mad about that. You know how hard he didn't mean to do that to that kid. But he did harm. He did harm by being more concerned about the tradition than being concerned about a human being. A child of Abraham who had the opportunity to find new life. I can give lots of examples, but I'm not going to. Well, maybe one more. One more, okay? One time, I was in a church, not this church, a different church, a long time ago, someplace else. And we had these kids coming to church who, their families didn't go to our church. They would come on Wednesday night. And so we just bought stacks of pizza, like we do here. And every kid that showed up, we didn't ask any questions. We just gave them pizza. And there was a lady in the church who said, did they make a reservation? Like, This kid is 12 years old. He doesn't know where he's going to be tomorrow. He doesn't know where he was yesterday. He can't remember what he did in third period. He's not going to make a reservation. Well, their parents ought to be paying for that pizza. Their parents don't come to church. This kid's parents don't want this kid to come to church. Do we have to get indignant about the slice of a pizza? One time I had a staff meeting, and the church staff afterwards always called it the donut staff meeting, because I got on a tear about people complaining about how much the donuts cost. Now, y'all don't do that here. I'm just saying. Y'all aren't like that. Y'all aren't like that. But man, there's a temptation in all of us to fall in love with our ways and to get burned up inside when something isn't fitting the way we think it ought to go. And when we do that, we miss a party. We miss joy. That's what we miss out on. When we're indignant about our ways not being followed, then we miss out on joy. All the people rejoiced. But the preacher was grumbling in the corner. You know who was rejoicing more than anyone? God in heaven. Who had wept with his daughter every time she had wept. Who had suffered with her every time she had been in pain. And Jesus rejoiced at the setting free of a broken body, a broken heart, a broken life. And he invites us to rejoice with him in his great work of redemption for all people. It's a fun exercise to go through the Gospels and see what makes Jesus mad. And this is one thing that makes him mad. He says, "You hypocrites." You hypocrites who have come here to talk about the love and grace of God. You hypocrites. You know what a hypocrite is? A hypocrite isn't somebody who isn't perfect. All right? Sometimes people say, "Oh, the problem with the church is it's full of hypocrites." You know, they come to church and they seem like they're holy because they're at church, and then when they're not at church, they're not perfect. You ever heard that kind of talk? Well, there's no better place for a hypocrite than a church. You know what I'm saying? But being a sinner and coming to church doesn't make you a hypocrite anymore than being sick and going to a hospital makes you a hypocrite. What makes you a hypocrite is to wear a mask, to condemn others for being broken when we ourselves are broken. To be more concerned about our rules being followed when we too are in desperate need of being set free. To be a hypocrite is to lose a soft heart that's able to rejoice when God's grace makes a life new. Today we'll leave this worship service and we'll enter into a world that is groaning under the weight of its own broken ways. Each person that we'll meet is trying to put a happy face on the suffering that is part of the human condition. We all have a swirling sea underneath. We cover up with strained smiles. The good news of the gospel is this: God loves people like us. We can take off the mask. We can abandon our indignation, and we can find joy in the healing that God offers us all. God never leaves us alone in our struggles. And when we come to Him with humility and an open heart, healing can happen. And so this week, rejoice in God's work in your life and rejoice wherever you see God working in the world and in the people around you. Never put up a barrier. Never walk through life with your eyes cast down, ignoring the human beings, the precious children of God that you encounter each day. Receive all the grace that's extended to you. See one another and offer grace in the measure it's been given to you. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to turn in your hymnal to number 408. That's our hymn of invitation. Anyone who'd like to spend some time at this altar of prayer before your God is welcome. The heart of the Lord is open to you. The altar is open to you. Let us avail ourselves of the grace that has been made available to us in this our hour of need. Please stand as we sing. Please turn in your hymnals to number 38. We are excited to be welcoming Drew and Heather Gardner and their daughter Erin into membership in our church today. They're transferring from another denomination. And so I have a few questions for you. First of all, as members of Christ's Universal Church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church, do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? As members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service? Members of the household of God, I commend the Gardeners to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, to confirm their hope, and to perfect them in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you. We welcome you in Christian love, as members together with you in the body of Christ, and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. May the God of all grace, who has called us into eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. We welcome you in Christian love. Will you welcome the Gardeners? Following the benediction, I invite you to greet them on the way out.
Therefore, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. May you go in peace.